Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Baddest Girl on the Planet by Heather Frese, narrated by Courtney Patterson. 1. Kid Dynamite, 2013. My husband is not the first man to disappoint me. That honor goes to Mike Tyson, who I met the summer I was 9. The summer I left Hatteras Island to stay in Ohio for 2 weeks with my Ohio friend, Charlotte. Charlotte and I became friends while her family was camping on the Outer Banks, and I was allowed to take a sort of reverse vacation to the hills of Ohio. Charlotte's family lived in a pretty, white, two-story house with blue shutters and dollops of woodworking around the front porch. I still think about that house and those green, green hills. About how every day seemed green and blue and gold. But maybe that's just how every day feels when you're a kid. Charlotte lived next door to Don King, and at that time he promoted Mike Tyson, along with a bunch of other guys, who all trained in tents in his backyard. Every day, Charlotte and I would gather up her friends, Sarah M. and Sarah N., and make the boxers watch us turn cartwheels. They would stop their jump roping and shadow boxing to look at us and applaud. Just like they really cared. When I got home, I bragged about Mike Tyson to all my friends. I was the toast of the fourth grade for an entire school year. Then Mike Tyson raped a girl. Real quick, I stopped saying he was my best friend, but kids don't forget things like befriending rapists. This did not help my social standing. Little girls who are best friends with rapists rarely remain popular. Except for Charlotte, who got off the hook because everyone in her town thought Mike Tyson was a good guy. Still, Charlotte and I stayed close, partly because I didn't have many other friends. And then, a few years later, just when I thought my Tyson-induced social pariah status had begun to blow over, he bit Evander Holyfield's ear off. I never mentioned Mike Tyson to anyone again. My husband is not the second man to disappoint me in my 23 years on this planet, not the third or the fourth. So by the time his disappointments start to really roll in, you'd think I'd be braced for them. You'd think his metaphorical ear-biting would not come as a complete and total shock. You'd think I'd be prepared for it when Stephen says, "Evie, we need to sell the house." But I'm not. "What do you mean, sell the house?" I say. It's morning, and the light slices down through my window into my crazy, cozy little kitchen, where I spend so much time boiling and baking and basting as a way to breathe. My house is not big and dollopy, and it does not have a front porch, and there's not a bit of gingerbread trim anywhere. But it's white and snug and bright, and mine. I think of the morning after we moved in, when Stephen and I sat on the floor and laughed about owning 6 blenders. Stephen leans against the counter like he hasn't a care in the world. Casual. He eats a bagel. He's wearing khaki pants, and I wonder if he's going in to work at his father's store today.
"I was talking to Royce Burris at your office when I picked you up the other day, and he said we could get a good sum for the property," he says.
I squeeze out a dish rag and wipe at the kitchen table, looking down and hoping that Stephen doesn't see my face color at Royce's name. I have a tiny crush on Royce. I take a second and listen to the loud commercial blasting from the television room where my son, Austin, is watching TV. But where would we live?
"I'm not saying it's a perfect plan," Stephen says.
He crosses the kitchen and sits down in front of me at the table.
"But we could stay with your folks or mine until the cash clears and then build somewhere."
I sit down. This sounds like an okay plan. This sounds thought out and maybe even mature. But I know Stephen's teeth are awfully close to my ear. Stephen links his fingers together and makes them into a steeple.
"We could build on the mainland. It'd be a hell of a lot cheaper."
And there it is. He wants to leave the island.
Chomp.
"Maybe if you got an actual job, we wouldn't be so strapped that we have to sell our home," I say. I lean forward on the table and my arms get sticky from the damp dish rag. Stephen's mouth tightens. It's an old argument, and it goes like this. I say, "Get a job." He says,
I'm staying at home with Austin. I say, you're never home with him, and I know this because I drop him off at my parents' every day before I go to work while you fuck around on your jet ski. He says, I'm above working any jobs on this island. He doesn't say it in exactly those words, but that's what he means. And that's what he honestly, truly believes. But it's not below me to answer phones and make coffee and peddle beach houses to tourists every day because I'm just that low. He believes this, too. I know it. Stephen crosses his arms and the sunlight glints off his watch.
I have a job, he says.
Part-time stock boy for your father doesn't count, I say. He works in the back where no one can see him and does it out of obligation to his father. His father, who basically gave us this house. Stephen shakes his head.
God damn it, Evie, he says.
Austin can hear you, I say.
He can't hear a fucking thing over that goddamn TV.
But Stephen lowers his voice all the same.
I don't know why you let him watch it so much.
I stand up. You're the stay-at-home father. Why don't you monitor him? I cross to the living room where Austin sits on his knees, entranced by Go Diego Go. My son is small and dark-haired, and I'm always a bit thankful that he looks like me. Come on, kid, I say, reaching down to pull him up from under his armpits. Time to go to Grandma's. Austin has the charming habit of kicking the passenger seat on our daily rides up the island to drop him off at my parents' inn. I guess if I was strapped down in a car seat, I'd kick too. But it doesn't ease my annoyance. And I am strapped down, come to think of it, with my own seatbelt. How about you cut that out, buddy? I say. I glance at the rearview mirror, but Austin's looking away. I want to hear the Holla Back song, he says, and I die a little inside. Every day he wants to hear Holla Back Girl. This was cute at first, until he started singing, I ain't no harlot snack girl. And I had to correct him over and over so people don't think my kid knows about harlots, even though I know he has no idea what it means. He wants it every day. Every day we drive up the same road and listen to the same song, and I think of Charlotte saying you can't get lost on an island because pretty soon you'll drive off the end, and right now I want to drive off the end. But I pop in the cassette I've recorded from my dad's old stereo and think about how Stephen goes jogging every morning with his iPod. And then I make myself think about how I want Austin to grow up with a family, with a mom and a dad and a little white house. A little white house that once held 6 blenders. A little white house that Stephen wants to sell. The morning is bright and sunny for February, and the Pamlico Sound spreads out in shades of blue and gray and green as Highway 12 passes close to the water. Austin kicks the seat in time to the music. I fumble for my sunglasses and sing along with Gwen Stefani. I would not be the first person in my marriage to have an affair. I think about this as Royce Burris walks in the front door of the office, the little bell jangling his presence. Royce is easily in his 50s. His hair is brown and thin, and he has a small, rounded gut. I find this endearing. I want to rub it like a Buddha belly. I debate whether it'd be too forward to tell him so. Royce, I say, you are one sexy son of a bitch. Let me rub your belly. Royce looks startled, yet pleased. This is a notch up from our normal morning routine. Usually, I tell him he's a beast, and he says I look nice in whatever I'm wearing. Royce crosses over to where I sit at the receptionist desk, puts down his briefcase, and shrugs off his jacket. He smells like the outdoors, and his hair is tousled. Royce props an arm on the tall desk.
How's my sunshine today?
He asks. I feel the familiar zing at his closeness, the stir in my belly and warmth in my face. I think about what it would be like to touch his arm. I'm mad at you, I say. I pout up my mouth in a way I hope is cute and sexy.
Are you now? He says.
His eyes crinkle, and he doesn't look concerned. Why'd you go and tell my husband we should sell our house? Royce walks around the back of the desk to stand beside me, and I spin in my chair to look at him.
I was just bullshitting with him, Royce says.
He draws his eyebrows together. I find this endearing, too.
Does he seriously want to sell?
I cross my arms.
Anyone who got that house would just knock it down and build a monstrosity. And they would, too. A pastel McMansion monstrosity.
I'm sorry, Royce says. Didn't mean to put a bug in his ear.
Royce reaches out his hand, and I think he's going to touch my face, and my heart pounds. But then he just smooths his hair and puts his hand back down. I try to breathe. Get yourself to your office, I say. The tourists need you.
Royce gathers up his stuff and walks down the hallway. He turns, walks a couple backward steps, and says,
I'll make it up to you, Cupcake.
And I just bet he will. Most of the time, my job is kind of fun. I make copies, and I make coffee, and I answer the phone, and when all the agents are busy, I help clients select beach houses. I have a good memory for which house has what feature, and I'm quick at pulling it all up in the database. So when a Mr. John Bo Cook from Roanoke, Virginia, calls and wants to reserve I'll be back for 2 weeks in July, I tell him right away it's not available.
Mr. Cook, I say, I'm really sorry, but that house was reserved by someone else 3 months ago.
Mr. Cook is not pleased. He tells me he wants that house. He says,
If you can't get that house for me, then you're good for nothing.
He has a raspy, twangy voice. I want to tell Mr. John Bo Cook to go fuck himself, but I root through the listings and suggest he try mullet over or not a gull. Mr. Cook is insistent. He wants I'll be back. I click around on the computer a little more.
It's open for a week in May and a week in September, I say.
But Mr. John Bo Cook says it has to be July. He tells me I'm bad at my job. He says,
Listen, you little whore, I'm the client, and it's your job to make me happy. Right now, you are not making me happy.
This hurts my feelings. I'm good at my job. In 4 years of working at Outer Banks Realty, I've never had anyone speak to me like that. I'm a little bewildered, to be honest. And then I get past that. Then I get mad.
Listen, John Bo Cook, I say. You can take your beach house and shove it up your flabby white double-named ass.
And I hang up. I stare at the phone and fight the urge to run down to Royce's office and tell him about it. Luckily, Pansy Friedman comes down the hall at that moment, and I tell her about the whore and the hanging up and all of it. I start to worry I might get fired, but Pansy says every once in a while we get one like that, and not to worry, and why don't I take an extra long lunch? This is fine with me. Without really thinking about it, I head down the hall, out the back door, and down the steps. I forget my jacket, but it's a nice day. In the high 40s and sunny, so I traipse across the scrubby back lawn to my tree. I used to eat lunch here every day when I was pregnant with Austin. It has a low branch that sticks out like a bench, and it's pretty in the summer when the sun shines through the leaves. But of course, there are no leaves now. I pull out my phone and check on Austin. He's fine and eating cherry jello. I call Stephen.
What's up? He says.
Some guy called me a whore today,
I tell him. I kick at the ground and stir up some dead leaves.
Did he know you in high school?
Stephen asks. He laughs. For the second time today, I hang up the phone on someone. Most of the time, my job is kind of fun, but other times, it's downright boring, especially in the winter. By afternoon, I'm skimming the internet, clicking through the news sites and anything else that hasn't been blocked. I learn about the world's friendliest countries, Canada, Germany, and Australia. I turn the sound down and watch a video of kittens riding a Roomba, then read about how to dress slimmer. The key, it seems, is not to mix tight with shiny and to stay away from high-waisted jeans. I don't know why anyone would wear those in the first place. I start to research the slenderizing properties of Spanx undergarments when I hear a rustle behind me and turn around to see Royce. I switch off the computer monitor quick as I can.
I promised I'd make it up to you, Royce says.
He holds out a little white takeout box.
He smells good, and it distracts me.
Did you get me a corsage? I ask.
I take the box and shake it.
Is it a pony? Did you get me a pony?
I open the box, and ooh,
It's a fat square of baklava from a restaurant up in Buxton run by two Eastern European guys. And I don't care if their country doesn't make the world's friendliest list, because if there was a world's best baklava list, they'd top it. The first time I had their baklava, they'd just taken it out of the oven, and the warm, sweet, honey, flaky crustiness was the best thing I'd ever had in my mouth. "Thanks, Royce," I say, standing up to give him a big hug. It starts out as a nice, spontaneous crusher of a thank-you hug, but pretty soon I'm all too aware that my nose is buried against his neck and his hands are sliding down my back, and I really want to grab his ass. But I let go because it's an open office and anyone could come by.
"I remembered you talking about it last week," Royce says, in an aw shucks kind of way.
I turn around to my desk and set down the baklava. Then I scribble the words, "If you want to share, stay late tonight," on a neon green post-it and stick it to his left palm. Royce looks down at his hand, and I just about die from the expression on his face, a mix of surprise and pleasure and confusion, like he's not really sure what I mean but is intrigued to find out. After he leaves, I sit down and call my mom to see if she can keep Austin through dinner. I know I've made the right choice when I see that Royce has stuck a little plastic fork into the box of baklava. I lean back and take a bite. Our affair doesn't have a very interesting trajectory. There aren't any longing glances and stolen moments, just pretty regular sex in the office after hours. After a couple of months, I decide I'm falling in love with Royce. It's crazy. It's not like he can bring me flowers or take me out on a date, but he's kind, and he walks me to my car afterward. I still think he's a sexy son of a bitch. Everyone knows. Of course everyone knows. Or suspects. It's a small office in a small town on a small island. I make sure not to take the affair home with me, but it's only a matter of time before Stephen calls me on it. I think the moment has come one night at dinner when Stephen says,
"I know what you're doing, by the way."
He spears a bite of salmon and watches me as he chews. I reach over and wipe at Austin's mouth. He's been on a SpaghettiOs kick and has red sauce all over his face. He squirms out of my reach and I give up.
"What do you mean?"
I ask Stephen. I'm not even nervous. My heart doesn't pound. I'm resigned and a little relieved.
"I know you're spending above our limit, so there's nothing left for me to go back to school with," he says.
I sag back against my chair. And then, a second later, I'm pissed. Austin needed an outfit for karate, and then he had his checkup. I'm not just spending money to spend money.
"Mom," Austin says.
He puts down his spoon.
"What's bigger, a hippo or a jaguar?"
"This is what I mean, Evie," Stephen says. "We don't need to be spending money on karate lessons."
"Hippo or jaguar?"
Austin asks. Stephen looks at me.
"Austin's asking you a question," he says.
"Hippopotamus," I tell Austin. "He needs to be around other kids, and it's good for him," I say to Stephen.
"And what about the bill from the salon?"
Stephen asks. He stopped eating his food.
"Okay, that was bad, an unnecessary pedicure, but I'm not admitting it to Stephen. I needed a haircut," I say, like Stephen would even notice I hadn't had one.
"Mom," Austin says, "is a lion or a tiger bigger?"
"I'm not sure," I say.
"Why?"
Austin asks. He pushes his finger into what's left of his SpaghettiOs.
"They're about the same," I say. I wonder when I became the poster girl for National Geographic.
Stephen stands up and takes his plate over to the sink.
"You should have asked me about the karate first," he says.
"A humpback whale or a condor, Mom?"
Austin asks. He pushes his finger in rapid circles on his plate.
"Stop playing with your food," Stephen says.
"Whale," I say. "Whales are really big."
"Did you hear me?"
Stephen asks me.
"How could I not?"
I reach over and hold Austin's arm still. When he looks up at me, his eyes are big and dark. I relax my grip.
"We'll talk about it later,"
Stephen says. He walks into the living room and turns on the TV. I take Austin's plate and finish his SpaghettiOs. They're cold and clammy, and the thin sauce tastes like the can.
"Mom," Austin says, I stand up and pile our plates together.
Yeah, baby. A sloth or a penguin?
I used to have a thing for Sherpas. Actually, I still do. If that doesn't end up working out as a career path, I'd want to be a whirling dervish. I watched a show on the Travel Channel about them once. They spin and spin and spin. That's how my head feels lately when I'm with Royce. It spins and spins and spins. I'm leaning back against him, and his office is dark, and the purple lace Victoria's Secret bra I mail-ordered is on the floor. Royce snuggles me closer.
"What are you thinking?"
he asks. Sometimes Royce asks me this question after. This time I give him an honest answer.
"I'm thinking of leaving Stephen,"
I say. I burrow under his arm a little more. Royce doesn't stiffen, but by his silence I'm afraid I've said something wrong. I nibble on my lower lip. It's sore from kissing.
"I didn't mean for you," I say. "But this might be a lie. I might want him there to catch me."
Royce turns me around to look at him.
"Evie, honey," he says, "there are plenty of fish in the sea, and you just caught yourself a largemouth bass."
I squint up at him. His hair is rumpled, his head silhouetted against the back of the sofa. A largemouth bass. I cough. I picture my son asking,
"Mommy, what's bigger, a largemouth bass or a carp?"
I press my face into Royce's chest and try not to giggle. Stephen, for all his faults, would never say anything that corny. My husband is one sharp cookie. To be honest, I feel bad he had to quit school when I got pregnant. To be honest, I feel bad about a lot of things. Royce must mistake my silence for me being overcome with emotion because he says,
"Don't cry, honey. It'll be okay. I'll take care of you."
He rubs his hands up and down over my shoulder. The gesture irritates me. I think of what it would be like to wake up every morning to Royce Burris rubbing my shoulder up and down like that. I think of having to tell him to smooth down his hair or iron his shirt. And then, inexplicably, I think of Mike Tyson. I think of Mike Tyson, good old Kid Dynamite, grinning at me with that gap-toothed leer, and I want to put my hand over my ear just in case another man who I thought was a good man turns out to be bad. There are way too many things spinning around in my head, and somehow this has the paradoxical effect of making my head stop spinning for Royce. Royce's hand slides down my arm and rests in the curve of my waist, then moves down again. I look up at him, shifting his hand off. His hair and eyes are the exact same color, and this annoys me. He looks at me, big and mopey and pleading. I get up and put on my bra. It's a pretty Saturday, so I pack up a picnic and take Austin to the beach. Stephen is off somewhere, doing something. I don't even bother asking what. I think it'll be good for Austin to get away from the television. Austin holds onto my hand as we walk over the dunes. He holds onto my hand as we stroll down the beach. He holds onto my hand as I try to fix the blanket and spread out lunch.
"Baby, you need to let go,"
I say. I shake his little hand in mine, then feel guilty as Austin stares up at me. He's got that look on his face like he's about to cry, the one where his upper lip curls into a baby Elvis snarl. I think about the summer I was 9 when Charlotte and I got on an Elvis kick, how we danced around her living room to blue suede shoes.
"Don't get all shook up,"
I say, even though I know he won't get the joke. I sit down on the blanket and Austin curls himself onto my lap. He sticks his index finger in his mouth, a gesture I thought he'd long since outgrown. I pull his hand down.
"Let's go look at the water before we eat,"
I say. It's barely April, so the water is too cold to get our feet wet, but Austin and I take our shoes off and walk along the shore. It's a gray-green, roly, crashy sort of a day, with long, lacy breakers and an onshore breeze.
"Look,"
Austin says, letting go of my hand. The air feels cool on my palm. He runs down the beach and points at something on the sand. It's a blue jellyfish, and it looks like a cross between a dildo and a conch shell with long, crinkly tentacles spreading over the sand. A Portuguese man-of-war. Austin reaches for it, and I swat his hand. He knows better than to touch a jellyfish.
He gives me the Elvis curl again, and I pull him to me.
The tentacles will sting you, I say. They're mean.
Austin buries his head in my stomach. He shakes his face back and forth into me. And then the little shit backs up a couple of paces and gives me this look and reaches out to touch the jellyfish again.
Austin, I say, grabbing his shoulder. What's your deal, man? I want to touch it, he says. It looks squishy.
He leans closer. Against my better judgment, I show him how he can carefully touch the roughly pink top edge without getting stung.
Stay away from the tentacles, I tell him. It's pretty, Austin says.
He crouches and runs his finger over the safe part of the jellyfish. It is pretty. The inside of it's filled with clear blue liquid, the color of a summer sky, or Windex, or that awful blue Kool-Aid Austin likes. But the Man of War is tricky, too, the way it pretends to be a harmless seashell, the way the tentacles look like seaweed. I pull Austin away and we go back up to the blanket, which is blowing away at the edges where the picnic basket doesn't weigh it down. I smooth things out and sit, then hand Austin a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. Austin looks at it. He pokes at it. He takes a bite and spits it into the sand.
What are you doing? I ask.
I root around for my own sandwich. Austin has grape jelly on the side of his mouth.
I hate jelly, he says. You don't hate jelly, I say. He loves jelly, especially grape jelly.
Austin throws the rest of the sandwich down. Grape jelly oozes onto the blanket, and I close my eyes so I don't scream at the thought of the extra laundry. Austin looks at me, and his I'm going to cry face is gone. He has an I'm going to pick a fight face instead, narrowed lips and sparky eyes.
Mother, he says very formally, I have always hated jelly.
And this is terrible, but I just want to smack him. I know he's not a dumb kid. I know he's not the only one who lives in a tense home that's not really a home at all. But when he says, Mother, I have always hated jelly, and sticks his index finger in his mouth, I want to smack him. I look out at the crashing waves, the rickety fishing pier. My hair blows back from my face, and the breeze is cool and crisp. I take a deep breath and push it out through my teeth, thinking of the funny hee-hee-hee breathing I did while I was in labor. I hand Austin half of my sandwich.
Then you'll just have to eat bologna.
You know what I've never understood about soap? Soap scum. Soap is supposed to make you clean, not create scum. And what do you clean it with? Because you sure can't use soap, at least not the scummy bar. Do you use a different bar of soap? Doesn't it just get scummy, too, from cleaning the original scummy bar? How can something clean be dirty and something dirty be clean? Has it ever really changed? I bend over the bathtub and scrub at the hard-to-reach back corner and wish we could afford an automatic shower cleaner, the one with the scrubbing bubbles. The front door slams and Stephen's footsteps clump up the stairs. I lean back on my heels and throw the sponge in the tub. The footsteps stop and Stephen is in the room with me, his face red and his hair messy.
Did you think I was stupid?
He asks. He paces around the room and hits his fist against the wall. I stand up. There's no way to answer this.
Maybe, I say.
Because you must have thought I was stupid to go and fuck Royce Burris and think I wouldn't find out.
My first instinct is to tell him to lower his voice, that Austin will hear, but then I remember Austin is with Stephen's parents for the afternoon.
How did you find out? I ask.
Curiosity always has gotten the better of me. Stephen looks at me like I'm a largemouth bass or something equally ridiculous.
If you must know, I went into the office to ask Royce to take the house off the market, and I saw your little love note on his desk.
Shit. I try a new strategy. It's not like I did anything you didn't do.
Stephen runs a hand through his hair.
So this is a revenge fuck?
He asks.
Maybe, I say.
I only say this to make Stephen mad, but it occurs to me that it might be the truth.
What does it matter? Besides, I ended it.
I did end it. I don't know why Roy still has love notes on his desk.
And that makes it okay? We can just go back to being happily married?
He huffs a little on the word happily. I turn away from Stephen to wash the shower cleaner off my hands. Did you think you'd get rid of me that easily? Stephen grabs me by the shoulders and turns me around, fast. The water still runs in the sink.
You are suffocating me, Evie. You are suffocating me.
And Stephen puts his hands around my neck. He presses for a second, moves my head back and forth once, then releases me. It doesn't hurt. He doesn't press hard. He doesn't shake me hard, but I start to cry all the same. Stephen lets go.
Jesus, why do we even bother? You're not worth it.
He steps back with his hands at his sides, breathing so I can see his chest rise and fall. I slap him. I slap him, and I push past him, and I walk out the door. I get Austin. Stephen gets the house. It was never really mine to begin with. It wasn't worth a fight. He sells it, though not through anyone in my office, and I get a little check for the 4 years I pretended it was my home. And sure enough, a few months later, I drive by, and it's not there. It's just gone, like it was never there at all. It's only a matter of time before some big pink thing is built in its place. Austin and I move into a room in my parents' inn until I can get back on my feet. I don't tell him Stephen is gone. I tell him Daddy's at work without mentioning that work is in Raleigh. I try to make it a fun summer trip to Grandma and Grandpa's, and whenever he wants to go home to the house that isn't, I let him get in the pool. It's summer, and I have to leave extra time to get to work because of tourist traffic. Plus, Austin throws a fit whenever I go. But at least I only have to drive up and down twice instead of 4 times now that Austin is already with my parents. I wonder if my son ever thinks of his days as green and blue and gold. Probably not. He probably thinks of his days in terms of transformers and whichever animal Diego is rescuing. I wonder if he registers the fact that Stephen is gone for good. One of Mike Tyson's trademark combinations was a right hook to his opponent's body, followed by a right uppercut to the chin. I don't know how he moved his hands that fast. People were afraid to fight him. He was that mean. I used to tell myself that maybe he wasn't so bad, that maybe he just liked to fight. There is something about having battles, some kind of adrenaline rush that makes you feel spiky and alive and full of power. Maybe that's what made him move so fast. Maybe he just craved the rush. But I don't really buy it. What I really think is that Mike Tyson was a bastard, like all the rest of them. I drive up the road, and it's a lovely end of the day, and I'm sure the sun is doing amazing, sparkly things on the beautiful, beautiful water. It's a view people drive thousands of miles to see. But I can't see it anymore. All I can see is the road. I'm 23 years old, and for 40 more years, I'll drive up and down this road to work and back again. I can't quit. I'll never go back to school or climb Mount Everest or meet a Sherpa or throw a whirling dervish out of whirl. Those days are gone, and now it's just this. This day, these wheels, this road. 2. Evolution of a bad girl. Bad girls are not good. They're not good at all, but they are interesting. They cut off their own pigtails, pull sea oats out of the ground on purpose, make up lies. Bad girls make up lots of lies, sometimes accidentally, sometimes on purpose. When they get bigger, bad girls wear too much eyeliner, make out in baseball dugouts, let boys touch their breasts, both breasts, but mostly the left one. No one writes songs about being good, good to the bone, big good John, good moon rising. Michael Jackson would never grab his crotch and sing, "You know I'm good." Bad girls don't know they're bad until someone tells them. They just get tired of hair sticking to the backs of their necks. They want to wash away. They want things to be interesting. But once they're told, they realize they've always been B-A-D, bad.
I just might be the baddest girl you'll ever meet. The baddest girl on the planet. 3. Part spell, part seance, part prayer. 1999. My name is Evie Austin. You say it like it's two letters, E-V. Sometimes that's how I sign my name, E-V Austin, even though I know it's not true. My middle name is Anne, so it should be E-A Austin to be true. My whole first name is Evelyn, but I hate that name. It sounds awful, like a little old lady. When my dad dropped off me and my brother to live for the summer at our Aunt Faye's house, which isn't a house at all, but a big old camper van, he took my face in his hands and said, "Evelyn, you be good." I hate being Evelyned. I crossed my eyes at him and turned my face away. Then he and Aunt Faye started talking. My Aunt Faye said, "No, I do not want to keep them at your house. What if she comes back?" And my dad said, "She's not coming back." They were talking about my mom, who moved to Buxton for the summer for an important job. If it wasn't important, she wouldn't have moved for the whole summer. Then my dad left and went to work. I am 9 years old, and now I'm a gypsy. I live in the National Seashore Campground in Frisco, North Carolina. Frisco is a town on an island, and this island is full of danger. My island has a nickname, and it is the Graveyard of the Atlantic. This is on account of all the shipwrecks it's caused. So that's one source of danger, things that cause shipwrecks, such as shifting shoals, which I learned all about from Mrs. Hammond in science class last year. There are many other dangers, including jellyfish, riptides, hurricanes, cactus, and brothers. My big brother, Nate, teases me all the time. I warn the tourists about sources of danger when I talk with them, but I leave my brother out, mostly because he's not a force of nature. It's a real big camper that we live in. You have to pull it with a truck. Aunt Faye stays in it all the time since she sold her house and hasn't yet got a new one. She says she likes it just fine. We're going to live here while our dad's busy with tourist season, since he'll be gone too much to take care of us. Dad comes to visit us most days before he goes to work at the restaurant. My mom has not yet come to visit. She's awfully busy being on the welcoming committee for the lighthouse movers from Buffalo, New York. That's another danger, erosion. That old ocean just ate away and ate away and ate away at the beach so much that the lighthouse, which is the tallest lighthouse in America, could topple over and wash off at any second. That's why it's getting moved. They're going to pick it right up and move it inland on a little train track, is what they're going to do. So it's very important to treat the lighthouse movers nice, or else they might ruin our lighthouse. No lighthouse would mean no tourists. Tourists love lighthouses. There's not a thing you can buy here that doesn't have a big old lighthouse on it. I've even seen dog hats with lighthouses on them. I wish I had a dog. But I wouldn't make it wear a hat, not unless it wanted to. Tourists love to buy things with lighthouses on them. But this is complicated. My dad says they are good for the economy. My dad works for a restaurant, and he feeds tourists every day. He works late, which is why he can't visit us every single night. He likes it when tourists buy things. My Aunt Faye says, "Tourists are a nuisance. Our economy did just fine for 200 years before they started showing up." Aunt Faye has a bumper sticker on her truck that says, "If it's tourist season, why can't I shoot 'em?" I don't tell anybody, but in secret, I like the tourists. They make summer exciting. I spy on them all the time. I get real low behind a sand dune and I watch them. But there's been nobody interesting yet at the Frisco National Seashore Campground, just a bunch of boring old fishermen. It is only June, so maybe the interesting tourists aren't out of school yet. The trick to spying is to stay very flat behind the sand dune while not getting cactus stuck in you anywhere. Cactus is a very real danger, and I know this because once I thought I had a cactus needle stuck in my foot for an entire week until my mom looked at my flip-flop and found a nasty needle buried in the plastic. I clear a space in the sand with both my hands for where I want to spy tonight. I make two circles, and I fan them out and make a big heart. Then I hunker down.
I hold up my pretend binoculars with one hand and move aside a couple of green sea oats with the other. I peep into campsite A14. A red tent. No people. I skulk forward, looking through my binoculars for rhinos. I'm on the vast plains of Africa, just like in The Lion King. I've been crossing this giant desert for 2 days, but the path to the oasis isn't as short as I'd thought. I keep going when, bam! From the corner of my eye, I see not one, but three rhinos. They're big, hulky, gray things with mean, pointed horns, and they're coming right at me. There's only one thing to do when you come face to face with three rabid rhinos, and that is to run. I run and run, tearing through the hot African sand, and just when I think I'm close to safety, I come up against a wide, black river. The current is strong, but I swim with hard, quick strokes. I kick my feet, and then I hear a voice from the oasis. "Evie!" the voice yells. I can't answer because I'm swimming for my life. Then again, louder. "Evie!" The mud of shore squishes between my toes, gooey, and I slush up onto the riverbank and collapse for a second, breathing hard. A shadow looms over me. Just when I thought the rhinos were the worst part of my worries, I see the evil face of Emperor Shang, the jewel thief I've just recently escaped. "Dinner's ready," Emperor Shang says. He squints at me. "I won't fall for your dastardly ploy," I say. I try to dash back to the river, to H-E double hockey sticks with the rhinos, but Emperor Shang grabs my arm. "You don't even know what dastardly means," he says. "I do too," I say. I shake my arm away. Older brothers think they know everything. "It means wicked." Nate strides toward our camper. I'm kind of hungry, so I follow him. "I don't want hot dogs again," I say. "Talk to the chef," Nate says. But Aunt Faye is not a chef. I've never seen her wear an apron or a big poofy white hat like the chefs in my dad's cookbooks, and she's never made anything other than hot dogs and SpaghettiOs in the 5 days we've been here. I follow Nate to campsite B8. Nate runs up the steps to the camper and slams the door. Aunt Faye's standing at the grill, shooing away a seagull.
"Filthy wretch," she hollers at it. "No better than rats with wings."
Rats with wings. I get a real clear picture of that in my head. Rats with pointy yellow teeth and long, slithery tails, wings flapping all around my head. I shiver a little. The seagull caws.
"You took your shower yet, Evie?"
Aunt Faye asks. I go up and look at the grill. Hot dogs. "Nope," I say. "I couldn't get to the oasis." Aunt Faye nods. She has short black hair and sharp brown eyes. Her hair blows around her head in the breeze.
"Rhinos?"
"Three." I sit down on the picnic bench.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.